Protected at all times, and we'll look forward to seeing you as soon as things open up more fully. We'd like you to join us if you want, if you can sing there watching TV, just a little talk with Jesus.
Good morning, church family and friends. It is great to worship Jesus Christ. During these times, we have to keep our eyes and focus on Him. Some of the brief announcements is that on Sunday, after the church service, we'll be having a brief congregational meeting. It will be on our Facebook Live site at Dassel Covenant Church. You can join us there if you would like, and you can reflect and give questions at that time. We do have some other announcements. Senior Sunday, which is next Sunday, we'll celebrate the graduation of our seniors, all seven of them. So you can join us online there. And if you are new with us, please just simply receive what Christ would give you today. For those of you who would like to continue to give to the ministry of Dassel Covenant Church, you can go to our website at dasselcovenant.org in the top bar. There's a donate online, or you can send in your offering to 251 Lake Street, Dassel, Minnesota, 55325, or drop it off at the church office. Our worship theme this morning is Matthew 20, 26 through 28. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. Holy Father, we thank you and praise you that you served us long before we were even worthy. Help us to follow in your footsteps and serve and be a blessing to others. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. I want to thank you for your generosity. You have been such a faithful church during this time. One of the ways you have given is through the ministry of the churches in the Twin Cities, that is Sanctuary Covenant, Community Covenant, and Destino Covenant, and you nearly gave over $4,000 for that. And so that ministry has helped immensely. This is one of the reasons why we give. In Psalm 103:2, it says, "Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits." We praise the Lord through our giving. Let us pray. Holy Father, we thank you and we praise you. It is a privilege to give to you, to the ministry, to be a blessing to others. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. I so enjoy that we are a praying church. I wish we could gather to pray more often, as we do on Monday nights from 6:30 to 7:30 and during this time of worship. We receive requests throughout the week. One request was from our friend Maddie Pankritz, who has a friend who has a daughter that had a heart transplant, and unfortunately, the heart is being rejected, and so we need to pray for Christina. We also are aware that times have changed again, and now the mask mandate for public settings makes life even more complicated. We will continue to pray for that and for a cure for the COVID-19 virus. Let's go into a time of prayer. Holy Father, we thank you and praise you that you are with us and you show yourself to us again and again. We are asking for you to do that in a miraculous way. For Christina, we pray that her heart would not reject her body, that she would be able to find healing and a cure, that she can get stronger and stronger each day. And Lord, as life continues to be complicated with the COVID-19 virus, we are praying desperately for a cure, for a vaccine that would bring healing and wholeness. And Lord, we admit that some of the things are hard for us to accept. The mask mandate that causes us to have to wear masks in public. Lord, help us to be gracious and patient. Help us to be loving towards other human beings. And Lord, we pray for those who are vulnerable, that they would not get this virus, that they would be protected. We pray for those who have gotten the virus, that we would pray for healing in their lives. We pray that they would be strong. We pray for those that are serving and helping people to be cured, to be protected. We pray for our leaders. We ask that you give them wisdom and humility in the decisions to make the right decisions. Lord, we pray for our entire church family. You would protect us, help us to serve and be a blessing to others. Lord, we thank you that we can cry upon you at any time, in any place, and you hear our prayers. Lord, we pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hello, my name is Adriana Forsman, and I'm the Youth Director here at Dassel Covenant Church, and I'll be reading scripture for you today. It comes from the book of Mark, chapter 15, verses 38 to 41. Mark 15, 38 to 41. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus heard his cry and saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Some women were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the Younger, and of Joses and Salome. In Galilee, these women had followed him and cared for his needs. Many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem were also there. God bless the reading from his word.
Before we look at James the Lesser, the unlikely disciple of Jesus, allow me to read another passage of scripture. It is Luke 6, 14 through 16. It is the list of the disciples. Simon, whom he named Peter, his brother Andrew, James, John, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon, who is called the Zealot, Judas, son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. There is very little information in the Bible about James the Lesser, except that which is his family. We know that his father's name was Alphaeus, and we also know that his mother's name is Mary. And then we also know some of his siblings. From the Mark 15 passage, we know that one of his siblings is named Joseph or Joses, that's his brother, and his sister is Salome. Although there is some speculation about other siblings, he possibly had another brother named Matthew, also known as Levi, who was a disciple of Jesus. But we really don't know a lot more than that. We know that his mother Mary was a devoted follower of Jesus. Why do I say that? Because Mary was one of the people that came and took the body of Jesus after it was crucified and prepared it for burial. We read about this in Mark 16:1. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, his sister, brought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. So what we can conclude is that he had a very devoted family in regards to the following of Jesus Christ. That's it. It'd make a very short sermon, but I'm going to go a little further than that. Many scholars have attempted to speculate as to who James the Lesser truly was. It doesn't help that James is a very common name in the New Testament. There are at least seven James identified throughout the New Testament. And then to make matters even more complicated, his mother's name is Mary, in which there are several Marys in the New Testament. Some have even speculated that James the Lesser was the half-brother of Jesus, although most scholars do not believe that. I came across this conclusion from William Stuart McBurney in his book, The Search for the 12 Apostles. The answer, which has apparently satisfied most of the scholars of the oldest branches of organized Christianity, is to make Mary, the mother of James the Less, a sister of Mary, the mother of Jesus. This reduces James the Less to the status of a cousin of Jesus rather than a half-brother. It is the question we will only know the answer for sure when we get to heaven. He's either called the Lesser because he was a smaller person in physical stature, younger, or even quieter. His name was Dick Dova. You probably have never heard of him, and neither have I. But he was a key individual in the production of the movie Star Wars: Return of the Jedi. What did he do? He was a key grip. And I know you've always wanted to know what a key grip does. A key grip, they're responsible for lifting, moving, carrying, transporting, rigging, operating, building, and placing production equipment where it needs to be. In other words, they do the dirty, hard stuff that goes unrecognized, except for in the credits at the end of the movie that none of us ever read, or few of us ever read, except for Dick Dova's mother. Yet, if we are honest, no movie would ever be produced without these kind of individuals. In some ways, that quite possibly was James the Lesser. He was the key grip for Jesus. The disciple behind the scenes, the one doing the unglamorous, unknown work that made it possible for Jesus to do his work. In fact, the church is built on a majority of James the Lessers, or key grips, if you want to think of it that way. In Mark 10:29-31, we read this. "Truly I tell you," Jesus replied, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields along with persecution, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first." And then we read in Matthew 20:26-28, "Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. James the Lesser was a servant. He took the back seat. The way Jesus calls us as disciples to be. In fact, in many ways, he embodied what we see in Philippians a little later. But James the Lesser is very key to us understanding what it means to be called a disciple. Christianity is so radically different than all other worldviews and world religions. Basically, it is the opposite in so many ways. We read that Christianity operates differently throughout the Gospels. In Luke 6, 27 through 31, we read, "But to you who are listening, I say, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. If someone slaps you on one cheek, turn to them the other also." That's different. And then we read a little later in Luke 6:27-31, "If someone takes your coat, do not withhold your shirt from them. Give to everyone who asks you, and if anyone takes that what belongs to you, do not demand it back. Do to others as you would have them do to you." Crazy, isn't it? It's so different. And then we read in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5:44, "But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." We even find this kind of teaching in the Old Testament in Deuteronomy 28:48. "Therefore, in hunger and thirst, in nakedness and dire poverty, you will serve the enemies of the Lord sends against you. He will put an iron yoke on your neck until he has destroyed you." Serving your enemy? Love, pray, serve, care for your enemy? Being the lesser, as James was, is not what most people today would aim at, is it? We feel that we need to win every conversation. Every debate on social media. We need to look better than another person. We need to be served rather than serve. And we could go on and on with how the world operates. But Jesus calls his disciples to operate in a different manner. And Jesus went on to model this for us. One of the ways he modeled it was to wash the feet of the disciples. The lowliest and humble task of putting others before himself. The fact that we know so little about James the Lesser is that he was comfortable about being the lesser. Few people want to be the lesser. Few people want to take the back seat. They want to be served. Whereas we know so little about James the Lesser, we can guess that he was okay with this. Unlike James, John, and their mother who asked to be at Jesus' right and left hand, James the Lesser, we don't know what his ambitions, what he asked Jesus for. But we know that he was one of the chosen, unlikely dozen, his disciple. Psychologist Dr. Adam Grant wrote this, "Givers seek out ways to be helpful and give to others. Matchers play tit for tat. They reciprocate and expect reciprocity. Takers focus on getting as much as possible from others." I would guess that most of the world are takers at worst and matchers at best. Few people are givers. Yet givers are the way Jesus operates, the way he expects disciples to operate. And I can't be for sure, but somehow it seems like James the Lesser was a giver and simply was willing to serve and do whatever he was asked to do so that Jesus could fulfill his mission. Philippians 2, 1 through 4 says, "Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded and having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind." Imagine a church, a community, functioning like this. The fact that we know so very little about James the Lesser lends to the idea that he didn't, like Peter and the others, need to be corrected as much as they were. Because it seemed like every time James, John, Peter would make a mistake, Jesus would take that as an opportunity to teach a lesson. But we never see that happen for James the Lesser. But we know that at least that when Jesus was arrested and went to the cross, that James the Lesser disappeared. So he wasn't a perfect disciple, but he was a quiet disciple. He was one that seemed to be behind the scenes all the time. What we do know about James the Lesser is that he was involved in many of the things that Jesus did while he was on earth. As we read earlier, the list, we read, "These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him." So he was part of the 12 that was involved with many activities of Jesus. We know that James the Lesser was sent on a mission to fulfill when Jesus was in his earthly ministry. We read in Matthew 10, 5 through 8, "These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim the message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give." We see that he was involved in a vital part of the ministry of Jesus while he was on earth. We also see that James the Lesser was at the Lord's table. We read, "When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. So he was at the establishment of what we practice called communion. We also know that James the Lesser was present after the resurrection of Christ. For we read this in John 20, 24 through 25. "Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, 'We have seen the Lord.'" So James the Lesser was present at many of the great things that happened in the life of Jesus. As you can see, I'm struggling to get information about James the Lesser. Depending on what reference or resource that you look at, you can discover multiple ideas of what James the Lesser did after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, where he served and how he died. And the more I looked, the more diverse it seemed to become, which is frustrating when I want to give you answers. Legend has it that James went to Persia and preached the gospel there, and that it was there that he was eventually crucified. But still others say that he came back to Jerusalem and he was arrested and stoned. But that seems to be confusing with the other James that we talked about. Although there seems to be a lot of confusion, there seems to be no absolute concrete information. We can be sure that he was chosen and called by Jesus, and that we can learn some lessons from his life. First of all, one of the things we can learn from the life of James the Lesser is that he was called by Christ to be his disciples. The greatest thing that you and I can learn and identify ourselves with is that we've been called and chosen by Jesus to be his disciple. That doesn't mean we get the glory. Hey, I'm a disciple of Jesus. What it means is we point and reflect ourselves to the glory of Jesus Christ, that he would call us to be his. I've been reading the Jesus Bible, and in the Jesus Bible, many scholars give their ideas and thoughts. And I came across this idea that I think really describes what it means to be a disciple, a believer, a follower of Jesus. Believers are expected to live lives that honor and glorify God. That's what you and I have been chosen and called to do, to bring glory and honor to Christ. The most important thing is to know that our identity is that we've been chosen by Christ to be his disciple, a student, a mentored individual that brings honor and glory to Jesus Christ. The second thing is that we can learn from James the Lesser is that we need to learn to put others before ourselves. This is one of the fundamental things that makes Christianity different than all other worldviews and religions. We put others and treat others as more important than ourselves. We learn to be givers rather than takers and matchers. And during this time of the COVID-19, it's been a struggle. It's gone on for so long. But we're still asked as followers of Jesus Christ to be givers so that other people are blessed. Of course, that means we're a work in progress, for none of us are perfect at this, are we? The ugliness of our selfishness seems to creep in places and times when we least expect it. As we grow, though, we can become more like Christ and maybe more like James the Lesser. It's hard to play second fiddle, to take the back seat. And yet that is what it means to be a disciple of Christ and to follow him faithfully. And the last thing is, we can learn this important thing about being a called and chosen disciple of Jesus like James the Lesser. We should live for the words Jesus said in his parables, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Let's be honest. We love to be recognized and praised. As early as we can probably even remember, or before we can remember, as a baby, as a toddler, we want the affirmation of our parents. As we end up getting a little older and going to school, we want our teachers and our peers to recognize us for our achievements and accomplishments. And as we get older, we finally get to work and we want appreciation, recognition. We want to receive a raise from our boss for the hard work we do. And to some degree, this is okay. But it's not okay if those things end up replacing what we've been called to do as a disciple of Jesus Christ. We need to live for the applause of heaven. For at the end of our life here on earth, the most important words we're going to hear besides "come in, enter the kingdom of God" are the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." I believe Those were the words that drove James the Lesser. We'll know more about this when we get to heaven. But James the Lesser was willing to be behind the scenes. He embraced that. It was who he was. And in many ways, we can embrace that too, to bring honor and glory to Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for people like James the Lesser, who were okay with being behind the scenes, to be a servant, to take last. Lord, teach us that those are okay things for us too, especially in a world today that is really messed up. Help us to know how we can be a servant, a blessing, and bring you honor and glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. In Acts, it says, it is more blessed to give than to receive. In Romans 12, it says this, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercies, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. God has called us to be humble servants in this world. Blessed are those who truly give, who do not seek to receive, but give for the glory of Jesus Christ. Let us go and do so. Amen.